and also in communion.
We pray together.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. Let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with all. Almighty God,
our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We acknowledge your sorrow and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who in his great mercy has promised forgiveness of sins to all those who with heartfelt repentance and true faith turn to him, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians, chapter 12, beginning at verse 1. Now concerning spiritual gifts, brothers and sisters, I do not want you to be uninformed. You know that when you were pagans, you were enticed and led astray to idols that could not speak. Therefore, I want you to understand that no one, speaking by the Spirit of God, ever says, let Jesus be cursed. And no one can say, Jesus is Lord, except by the Holy Spirit. Now there are varieties of gifts of the same Spirit, and there are varieties of services of the same Lord, and there are varieties of activities, but it is the same God who activates all in everyone. To each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. To one is given through the Spirit the utterance of wisdom, and to another the utterance of knowledge according to the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healing by the one Spirit, to another the working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another the discernment of spirits, to another various kinds of tongues, to another the interpretation of tongues. All these are activated by one and the same Spirit, who allots to each one individually, just as the Spirit chooses. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Hear the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John.
Glory to you, Lord.
On the third day, there was a wedding in Cana of Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. Jesus and his disciples had also been invited to the wedding. When the wine gave out, the mother of Jesus said to him, "They had no wine." And Jesus said to her, "Woman, what concern is that to you and to me? My hour has not yet come." His mother said to the servants, "Do whatever he tells you." Now, standing there were six stone water jars for the Jewish rites of purification, each holding 20 or 30 gallons. Jesus said to them, "Fill the jars with water." And they filled them up to the brim. He said to them, "Now draw some out and take it to the chief steward." So they took it. When the steward tasted the water that had become wine and did not know where it came from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew, the steward called the bridegroom and said to him, "Everyone serves the good wine first, and then the inferior wine after the guests have become drunk. But you have kept the good wine until now." Jesus did this, the first of his signs, in Cana of Galilee, and revealed his glory. And his disciples believed in him. This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
May I speak in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. So having had almost no Sundays of Christmas, we're now on the second Sunday of Epiphany, and there are two more to come. And where are we up to? Well, over the past couple of weeks, we have followed on from the Nativity narrative of Christmas with three steps or moments of Epiphany. As Miriam said last week, these three aha moments in Scripture, which point in some way to the identity of Jesus. The first being the visit of the wise men, identifying the infant Jesus as the promised Messiah. The second being a fast forward onto Jesus' adulthood and his baptism in the Jordan by John, identifying the adult Jesus as the Son of God. And today, the wedding at Cana, the miracle of water into wine, what John calls the first of his signs, Pointing to what? Well, presumably pointing to the fact that Jesus is God, and that through Jesus the glory of God is revealed. So let's interrogate this a little bit further. It's a normal enough occurrence, a family wedding celebration. Jesus is there, his disciples are there, his mother is there, maybe half the village is there. And we're generally given to understand that wedding celebrations could be lengthy in Jesus' day. And here we are, the party's in full swing, and the wine has run out. And like any savvy and caring family member or friend and experienced hostess, Mary spots the problem. And like any good and well-behaved son, Jesus does what his mum tells him and resolves the problem in a way that only Jesus can. Not running to the shop to buy more, but by performing the first of his signs and turning what we understand to be a vast quantity of water into the finest tasting wine. And so the party goes on. But here's where we come unstuck, right? Because of course, this is impossible. One man can't, in an instant, turn six enormous jars of water into six enormous jars of wine. And if they did, we would assume some sort of trickery might be involved. I'm really trying hard not to talk about suitcases and wine at the moment. Just move on. But so, in our immediate ponderings of what could possibly be going on here, we confront the fact that this is an impossibility. And we're left with some choices. One choice is to believe whether or not this could actually have happened. We could say, well, that's impossible, so we're going to not believe it. It must be a literary trick, perhaps. A parable, maybe, confused with reality, rather than a real thing that actually happened. Or another choice we might try to make is to ascribe a more kind of practical, palatable explanation. We might perhaps say, well, clearly, they were all so drunk that the wonderful cool water from the stone jars was just what they needed to rehydrate themselves and make themselves feel wonderful again. But the moment that we choose to do this sort of rational explanatory interpretation with just one hard-to-believe episode in Scripture, then very quickly everything else begins to unravel. What place virgin birth? What place resurrection? If we can't reconcile something more base like water into wine. So actually, as Christians, we don't really have a choice. The narrative reports that a miracle occurred. The impossible was made possible. And so, it is our choice to believe that this impossible thing did happen. And so we might want to just think about what that means. And here is where we get our epiphany, our sign. Since we've already ascertained that it's impossible that one man can't, in an instant, turn six enormous jars of water into six enormous jars of wine, then we're forced to think and to look more directly at the man and to reframe the question. What sort of man can, in an instant, turn six enormous jars of water into six enormous jars of wine? Aha, he said. Only God can achieve the impossible. Therefore, this man, this Jesus, this Messiah, this Son of God, must be God. Not just a human who is related to the one who makes all things possible, but a human incarnation of the one who makes all things possible. QED. And so the passage ends, his disciples believed in him. At the time, it was a miracle which challenged and transformed. A miracle which took something ordinary, water, and made it extraordinary, the best tasting wine, not just any old wine, the best tasting wine. The first moment, according to John, that the glory of God is made manifest in the person of Jesus. A palpable sign of things to come, which is then replicated throughout the gospel narratives and the traditions of our faith and churches through the ages. And in the tradition of the church, taking something ordinary and turning it into something extraordinary, which points to God, becomes what we know of as a sacrament. In baptism, ordinary water becomes the cleansing and anointing water of life. In the Eucharist, ordinary bread and ordinary wine become representative of and connected with the life, death and resurrection of Christ, as we reenact every week the moment Jesus says, "This is my body, this is my blood, do this in remembrance of me." The power of the miracle lies not in how it was brought about, but in what it shows us about Jesus. In the middle of an ordinary event, a wedding, a special event, but you know, a wedding, God reveals his absolute power to make the impossible possible, to take the ordinary and make it extraordinary. In this, God upends the expectations, even in the minute details. In the ordinary run of things, the best wine is served first, not last. In God's reality, our expectations are turned upside down when the best wine shows up last. And here's my favourite question. So what? What do we do with this? Well, I wonder. I just wonder if we spend so much of our lives feeling ordinary, being bogged down in the ordinary, that we don't see the extraordinary that's all around us, or that we fail to notice the extraordinary things that happen all of the time. There's nothing wrong with ordinary, it means regular, usual, customary. We're creatures of habit, and ordinary is good. Many of us like routine and structure. We like ordinary life. And part of our struggle in pandemic times perhaps has been that loss of ordinariness because everything is slightly different. But to what extent are we blinded to God's extraordinariness and abundance already in the middle of our everyday lives? To what extent have we forgotten what difference it might make to lift our eyes to Jesus, to God, for inspiration, for confidence, for miracle, for transformation. Today's epiphany, aha, for me, is the power of God's love in Jesus to be transformative, not just in the pages of Scripture, but in the pages of our own life's journey. Ordinary things can become extraordinary when they're blessed by God. God uses ordinary people. The disciples themselves were ordinary people before they were called. We are ordinary people. God chooses you and me, the people of the world. We don't boast in our own goodness. Our goal as followers of Christ, as Christians, is that Christ becomes more and more noticeable in us and in our lives. We want people to see Jesus in us. When people see the courage and wisdom of ordinary people that are simply obeying God, it stands out as being
from God. With God, ordinary things and ordinary people become extraordinary. Lord Jesus, changer of water into wine, taker of the ordinary in our lives, transform us daily for your glory and make us extraordinary for your sake, that we, with God's miraculous grace bringing up inside us, taking with us that abundance of love and power, may exude this wherever we go and to whoever we meet. Amen.
Especially for our own nation, the government, and our Queen. And we remember also the people of Tonga, where the volcano has erupted. Lord, in your mercy. Lord Jesus, you brought joy and wholeness to the wedding. Bring wholeness and love to all who are anxious, lonely, unloved, and poorly. We pray especially for those we name in our hearts. We pray also for those who have died, and we ask you to envelop those who grieve with comfort as they miss the physical presence of their loved ones. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, fill our hearts with gratitude for all the glory that surrounds us. Merciful Father,
accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Savior and Jesus Christ. Amen.
Rejoice the Lord.
His spirit is with us.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
Father, we give you thanks and praise through your beloved Son Jesus Christ, your living Word, through whom you have created all things, who was sent by you in your great goodness to be our Savior. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he took flesh. As your Son, born of the Blessed Virgin, he lived on earth and went about among us. He opened wide his arms for us on the cross. He put an end to death by dying for us, and revealed the resurrection by rising to new life. So he fulfilled your will and won for you a holy people. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and singing.
To call God our Father.
break this bread, to share in the body of Christ.
Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread.
Thank you.
and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be with you, your families, and those you love, this day and forevermore.
Amen.